Heavenly Father, we thank you and we praise you for your word. It is the truth. We do receive your word written in our heart, written in our mind. Thank you for the revelation of it. We will be doers of it and we will see the fruit of it in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated if you would. Today we're going to talk to you on the subject of angels and putting angels in operation. It is an important thing. You are to see angels be working on your behalf. We need to understand about angels. In Hebrews chapter 1, verse 13, to which of the angels said he at any time, sit on my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool? Well, who's the one that sits on the right hand of the Father? It's Jesus. The angels, what are they? Verse 14 goes on and tells you what angels are. Are they not all ministering spirits? Ministering means those that are performance of service. They serve God and they perform the word of God. Are they not all ministering spirits? And notice what they're to do. Sent forth to minister for them who shall be heirs of salvation. That means they're not only ministering for God, but they're also ministering for them who is us. Who's that? That's us, the heirs of salvation. They are going to minister on your behalf when you do what the word says and put them in operation. You and I are the heirs of salvation. We talk about these angels. This particular word, angelos, used 186 times in the New Testament here, as we see in the usage. 179 times it's translated angel, 7 times translated messenger. There's a Hebrew word which we'll see, malak, which is the word for angel, which again translated that the most of the times in the Old Testament. And these angels carry out God's word. They carry out the service of the Lord and bring forth the promises of God. There are good angels and there are bad angels, and we need, of course, to be aware of that. Good angels, of course, serve God. Evil angels are the evil spirits, the demons that serve Satan and carry out his destructive work. We see that the devil does have his angels. It declares it in Matthew chapter 25, in verse 41. Matthew 25, verse 41. Then shall he say also unto them on the left hand, depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire. And then he goes on and says, prepared for the devil and his angels. So, it was prepared for the devil and his angels because they rebelled against God. Notice, the devil has his angels. They are the fallen spirits, the angels that rebelled against God. And what are these angels? Angels are spirits. We already saw that they're ministering spirits in Hebrews chapter 1, but we also see in Psalms 104, in verse 4. It speaks of how he makes his angels spirits, his ministers a flaming fire. They're spirits, and they're like a flaming fire that go forth to carry out the things of the Lord. We must understand about angels that the type of body that they have and what they can do. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, down in verse 40, it speaks of the fact that there are celestial bodies and there are terrestrial bodies. Celestial, which would be heavenly bodies. Terrestrial refers to the earth. Those are earthly bodies, which would be physical. The glory of the celestial is one, and the glory of the terrestrial, of the earth, is another. Angels have celestial bodies, but they also can change and to appear physically, as you will see. We see in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 2, it even speaks that you could entertain angels unawares. You wouldn't know necessarily, but nonetheless they can. Hebrews 13:2, be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. They turned themselves into a physical form, and they can change themselves into all kinds of things. Angels have the ability to do that. We even see this further, that they change themselves into like appearing like a man or like a person, over in Daniel chapter 10. In Daniel chapter 10, in verse 16, where an angel showed up and was appearing here to Daniel, he said, behold, one like the similitude of the sons of men. He looked like the sons of men, like a man. touched my lips. Then opened my mouth and spake, and said unto him that stood before me, O my Lord, by the vision my sorrows are turned upon me, and I retained no strength. For how can the servant of this my Lord talk with this my Lord? As for me, straightway there remaineth no strength in me, neither is there breath left in me. The glory of the celestial is such that the glory of the natural can't even stand, and he couldn't even have any strength because of the presence of the angel. And there came again, there came again and touched me like the appearance of a man. He had one like the appearance of a man, and he strengthened me. Angels can appear like a person, like a man, and they will do all kinds of things. Revelation chapter 5. How many angels are there out there? A tremendous number. You can't even number them. He goes on and says in Revelation 5:11, Behold, I heard the voice of many angels round about the throne, the beast, and the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000. Well, that's 100 million, and thousands of thousands. And actually, there's more than that, in a sense, because that was just around the throne, because we know that Hebrews chapter 12 makes it very clear that there is an innumerable number. We can't even count the number of angels that are out there. Hebrews 12:22. You're coming to Mount Zion and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to an innumerable company of angels, an unlimited number. There's enough angels to go forth and to carry out everything that needs to be done of the Word of God in every single believer's life, and to also do warfare against the evil spirits and to conquer them and to see God accomplish all that he purposes. An unlimited number of angels. We see another scripture that even shows that forth over in Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter 33 in verse 22. As the host of heaven, referring to the angels, cannot be numbered, neither the sand of the sea measured, so will I multiply the seed of David, my servant, the Levites that minister unto me. So the host of heaven cannot be numbered. Again, there's an unlimited number of angels out there. Now, we also must talk about the bad angel. Satan was the leader of the one who became the bad angels. He was an angel in heaven. We see in Isaiah chapter 14, in verse 12, his name was Lucifer, and it says in Isaiah 14:12, How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which did weaken the nations? Notice what his job, what he does. He weakens the nations to try to bring destruction upon them, as he hates man, and he weakens the nations. Lucifer meant light bearer. He was a very beautiful creature, as you will see when we show you another passage of scripture, but he rebelled against God. Notice, for thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. He wanted to be like God. The five I wills. What does this show you? First of all, this shows you that angels aren't just some blob. They have a heart. They have a heart. And they can say things. They can speak words. They also have a will, and they can choose things. They can have their will set to obey God or to do things contrary. They're to be servants of God. He said, I will. All these different I wills. So they have all the attributes of personality. And we must understand that, of course, because of the rebellion, he said, what's he say in verse 15? Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell to the sides of the pit. Because of the rebellion, he was kicked out of heaven, which you will see in a moment. Over in Ezekiel, it also speaks referring to Satan, who was Lucifer. In Ezekiel 28 and verse 12, Son of man, take up a lamentation upon the king of Tyrus, and say unto him, Thus saith the Lord God, that sealest up the sum full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. He's talking to this king of Tyrus. And who is this king of Tyrus identified as? First of all, we'll go back and see that there was a prince of Tyrus who was a man. In verse 2, Son of man, say unto the prince of Tyrus, He was a real ruler over a place called Tyrus. Thus saith the Lord God, because thine heart's lifted up, he was full of pride, and thou hast said, I'm a god. A lot of these rulers thought they were gods all the time, but they weren't, of course. I sit in the seat of God in the midst of the seas, yet thou art a man. He says, no, you're a man. You're not God. Though you set your heart as the heart of God. These guys were deceived, run by the devil. But then we come back to verse 12, where it says the king of Tyrus. The king is over the prince. Who's the king of Tyrus? It was Satan. We see in verse 13, thou hast been in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was thy covering, thy sardis, topaz, diamond, beryl, onyx, jasper, sapphire, emerald, carbuncle, and gold. That means that apparently he was in Eden when the creation was of man was coming forth, and he was a beautiful creature at this point in time. This is after he fell, because he rebelled against God, because he wanted to be like the Most High, because what was man made? Man's made in the likeness of God, and the angels were jealous over that. They didn't like that at all. And so therefore, they rebelled against God. And notice, the workmanship of thy tabrets, that's tambourine, that would refer to rhythm, and thy pipes, this is referring to instruments, was repaired in thee in the day that thou wast created. He's a created being. And notice, music was in him, rhythm and instruments. This is why, what has Satan used, especially to capture people in the world today? Music. He's perverted music. He used all kinds of music that conjure up demons and lead people down a wrong path. He's used music to reach people. And you see most of the people out there that are walking in all kinds of rebellion, they seem to get into all this different kind of music. Satan has inspired this music. Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth. He was a cherub that covered the very throne of God. I've set thee so. Thou wast upon the holy mountain of God. Thou wast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. Thou wast perfect in thy ways from the day that thou wast created. He was created, and notice, God doesn't create anything that's bad. He created everything perfect. He created him perfect. Till iniquity, which means an injustice or an unrighteousness, that's what this word means, an injustice or unrighteousness or wrong was found in thee. That also shows you, angels have the ability, as we already saw, they have a will, they have the ability to sin. They have ability to choose to obey, or they also had ability to disobey. So here, iniquity was found in them. So Satan's the one who started all this as he rebelled against God. By the multitude of thy merchandise, they filled the midst of thee with violence, and thou hast sinned. That shows the fact that when you don't walk in God's ways and evil gets a hold of you, it will make a change on the inside of you. And violence took hold of him. What does Satan do? He continually does violence throughout the world. He's been doing it all along. He's continuing to do it today. And thou hast sinned. Therefore I will cast thee as profane out of the mountain of God, and I will destroy thee, O covering cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire. Because of his rebellion, because of his sin, he's kicked out and he's done. Thy heart was lifted up because of thy beauty. One of the reasons why he rebelled against God, because his heart was lifted up. He had pride because he was a beautiful creature. Thou hast corrupted thy wisdom by reason of thy brightness. He was a light bringer with great brightness, and so he was corrupted because of that. Because of his beauty, his pride, and his brightness, he thought he was something special. I will cast thee to the ground. I will lay thee before kings that they may behold thee. And that's exactly what happens to him. Thou hast defiled thy sanctuaries. The sanctuaries were the places where, sacred places this refers to, where he was ministering. By the multitude of thine iniquities, by the iniquity of thy traffic, therefore I will bring a fire from the midst of thee, it shall devour thee. And I'll bring thee to ashes upon the earth in the sight of all them that behold thee. He will be destroyed, and all of his works will be brought to destruction. Now, Satan rebelled. What else happened? Angels followed him. Angels followed him, and great mistake. We see in Revelation 12, verse 3, there appeared another wonder in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon, that's the devil, having 7 heads, 10 horns, 7 crowns upon his heads. He's had all these different governments, world governments that have come forth throughout the time. And his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven and did cast them to the earth. A third would refer to a third of the angels that rebelled against him. And so it's referring to the dragon. That is referring to Satan. And he is the one who rebelled. But the angels also, one third of the angels, followed him. We can see this clearly said when we see in 2 Peter chapter 2, over in verse 4. If God spared not the angels, plural, that sinned, they all sinned, but cast them down to hell. Hell is the word tartaroo, which refers to the lowest region where there was punishment for the angels. It referred to like in the lowest pit. And delivered them into chains of darkness to be reserved into judgment. Notice, people have thought, well, they must be chained, so how could they get out of there? It's not talking about chains where they couldn't go anywhere. It just says chains of darkness. What does that mean? That means they can never come to the light. They're chained in darkness. They're in darkness forever. They never can come to the light, which means there's no reconciliation for angels. There have been those that have taught ultimate reconciliation that angels are going to be restored too. It's a lying teaching. That's a false teaching. Do not believe it. They're in darkness, everlasting chains of darkness, as you'll see. We see also it speaks of this over in Jude, verse 6. The angels which kept not their first estate, or their place, first place, they left their own habitation. And they made a big mistake. He has reserved in everlasting chains under darkness. They can never come to the light. They're in darkness forever. Unto the judgment of the great day when they're going to be cast into the lake of fire. And they're going to be tormented forever because of their rebellion against God. So we see that because there were an innumerable number of angels and one third of them fell. Well, there's pretty much an innumerable number of evil spirits that are out there. But there's more that are with God, of course, than with the enemy. Same time, God's power is stronger, of course, than the enemy's. But nonetheless, these angels out there serve the devil and carry out his destructive work. Now, what about angels? Angels are strong and they are mighty. Judges chapter 13, over in verse 3. Here is when the angel Lord appeared unto the woman, the wife of Manoah, when Samson was going to be coming forth. And he said unto her, behold, now thou art barren and bearest not, but thou shalt conceive and bear a son. So this angel appeared before him. And it come down to verse 6 and the description that the woman gave of the angel. The woman came and told her husband, saying, a man of God, she thought it was a man of God, but it was an angel, came unto me, also showing that he appeared as a man. They can change into different forms. And his countenance was like the countenance of an angel of God. This vision, his appearance, very terrible, very fearful, this means. Otherwise, he had quite an appearance. He was very fearful. Angels are mighty, they're strong, they're very powerful. They excel in tremendous might and strength. I asked him not whence he was, neither told me his name. By the way, angels don't tell their name. We come down here further, and we come down to verse 17. It's interesting that when Manoah said to the angel of the Lord, what is thy name? That when thy sayings come to pass, we may do thee honor. Just talking about the angels that serve God. Outside of the angels that God has named, do angels themselves tell their names? Unless they're commissioned by God, no. The angel of the Lord said unto him, why askest thou thus after my name, seeing it's secret? They don't tell their names. What does that tell you? All these people that think that an angel spoke to them and told them their name, it was a lie, it was a devil. How did those cults get started? Most of them, some angel supposedly with their name, you know, appeared to them and gave them something like golden plates or some kind, all these kind of crazy things. It was all lies, total deception, because the angels don't come and tell them. Same way a supposed revival that supposedly happened some years back in Lakeland, Florida, that was supposed to be a great revival in the body of Christ worldwide, and people came from all over the world, and TV networks were showing this forth. This was all not of the Lord whatsoever, because they were listening to an angel, him and the other so-called prophets that were supposedly the leaders of this, And the angel's name was M-O. Well, first of all, the angels don't give their names. Secondly, are angels females? No, they're always males. They should have known because the angel gave its name that it was false. And then they should have known because the angel said it was a female name. They should have known it was false. And these guys were so-called, thought that they were great prophets and apostles and leading a great revival and wrote all these books and spoke all over the country. And everybody thought that they were great. They're all deceived. Yes. Totally false. They should, if they'd have known the word of God, they would have known, oh, this can't be of the Lord. But unfortunately, we saw quite a reproach came upon the body of Christ worldwide because of that. And the fallout is even continuous today. Many people have been deceived, and many people have even followed with the evil spirits and the deception that came that affected people from the things that occurred at that time. It's terrible. What's the problem? People don't look at the word. If they know the word, they know this was false. And they would understand the truth. What else do we see about angels? Psalms 103. Psalms 103. Verse 20. Bless the Lord, ye his angels, that excel in strength. The word excel as the word gabor, which means strong and mighty. So that means they're strong and mighty in strength. And this is the word koach, which we've done studies on in the past. It means a power or strength that's manifested. So this is talking about how they were mighty in manifested power. And what do? They do his commandments. And they hearken to the voice of his word. That shows you what angels are. They're mighty. They're great power. They manifest the power of God. And notice that they're a performer of the word. They do the commandments of the Lord. They hearken to the voice of the word of God. That's very important because this also shows you how you put angels in operation to see them work on your behalf, which we'll talk about in a little bit. Also, what else about angels? In John chapter 20, we see over in verse 12. He saw two angels in white sitting, the one at the head and the other at the feet where the body of Jesus had lain. They were in white. And this white, the word white, this word leukos means light, brilliant, dazzling white. I mean, a white like you can't even imagine. A brilliant, dazzling white that was come forth. We see it also shown over in Matthew in chapter 28. Matthew 28 and verse 2. When there was a great earthquake, and the angel of the Lord descended from heaven, they come back and forth, see, and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance, what his look like, was like lightning. Absolute brilliant light. This is a little different word, like lightning. And his raiment was white as snow. This is the same word, leukos. Brilliant white. White is whiter than you and I can even imagine. Such brilliance, glowing. And they're usually people that have even seen them, described them as very strong, very powerful, and used many times 7, 8, 9, 10 feet tall. Huge, mighty angels. They're always male. They're never female. And they're not these little flying fat babies or stuff that you saw in Sunday school curriculums. They all ought to be eliminated. It's amazing that they would write that kind of stuff. We threw it all those out. I'm not going to show this to the kids. This is a bunch of deception, lies. You don't ever see them hardly ever shown in this. People have been totally deceived by whoever's made these curriculums. They obviously didn't read the Bible, that's for sure. They just, come up with whatever they wanted to. Now, these angels, as we mentioned, have the ability to change themselves into different forms. And it's also true of the devil. Look what it says in 2 Corinthians 11:14. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. He comes. Many people have had appearances, and they thought it was a great light coming from God, but it was the devil, and they brought forth things that were false. But because of the way it showed up, they thought it was the Lord, but it wasn't. Thought it was an angel from God. It's false. Another thing that's important is that angels do not procreate. In Mark chapter 12, we see over in verse 25. When they rise from the dead, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, talking about us after we're resurrected, but are as the angels which are in heaven. The angels in heaven, they don't procreate. They don't procreate at all. They don't reproduce. That also shows you that all these ones that think that angels came and mated with women and produced so-called giants, as they said, the Nephilim thing, is a lying teaching from the devil. It's all false. Yes. Total false. Mm-hmm. It's amazing that they just ignore the word of God. And even where it talks about back in Genesis chapter 6, if you understand what I'm talking about, when it talks about in verse 4, it says, there were giants in the earth in those days. They were there already. And also after that. Well, is that before? No, that's after that. So giants were already here, right? Mm-hmm. That the sons of God, and people try to say that the sons of God is referring to these fallen angels that came into the daughters of men and mated with them and produced children. The so-called Nephilim, which is all a lie. The giants were already here before they did that. It says after that, following. No question. This is talking about the sons of God are the ones who were following God, that made a mistake instead of following God. They started mating with the daughters of men who were the ones who weren't following God, and that was a mistake. And bear children to them, became mighty men. They were men, which were of old, men of renown. And they weren't talking about angels at all. The teaching that says that is absolutely a lie. We have so many lying teachings out there, unfortunately, in the body of Christ. It's astounding. In Genesis chapter 18, and of course, this has given rise to a lot of the fables, the false fable books. Don't ever believe anything as any of these fables that tell you all these things that are contrary to the Word of God. The Word is the truth. We don't want to be deceived by fables. And the Bible warns us about the Jewish fables. And we got them all over the place today. And people are listening to them. Genesis chapter 18, verse 8. Took butter and milk and a calf which he had dressed and set it before them and stood by them under the tree, and they did eat. They said to him, where is Sarah the wife? And he said, behold, in the tent. And I'll certainly return unto thee according to the time of life, and Sarah thy wife shall have a son. And Sarah heard it in the tent door. This is when the angel had appeared, and this angel that showed up, notice, he ate. Angels can eat. So they could appear before you. They could sit there and have lunch with you or whatever if you entertain angels unaware. They can eat. Now also about angels, how fast do they move? They move at the speed of light in an instant of time. In Ezekiel chapter 1, we see in verse 4, I looked and behold, a whirlwind came out of the north, a great cloud, and a fire enfolded itself, and a brightness was about it, and out of the midst thereof was the color of amber, out of the midst of the fire. And also out of the midst thereof came the likeness of four living creatures. Their appearance, they had the likeness of a man. They can change into all kinds of things. Four faces, one had four wings. Angels have wings. Feet were straight feet, sole of the feet like the sole of a calf's foot. They sparkled like the color of burnished brass. They had the hands of a man under their wings on their four sides. They four had their faces and their wings. Again, these are angels that have wings. Their wings were joined one to another. They turned not when they went. They went every one straight forward. As for the likeness of their faces, the four had the face of a man, the face of a lion on the side. The four had the face of an ox on the left side. The four had the face of an eagle. They can have all these things. It's different forms. This were their faces. Their wings were stretched upward. Two wings of every one were joined one to another, and two covered their bodies. This is all talking about angels. And everyone that went straight forward, whither the Spirit was to go, they went, and they turned not when they went. They just went just immediately. There's the likeness of the living creatures. Their appearance was like the burning coals of fire, and like the appearance of lamps, it went up and down among the living creatures. The fire was bright, and out of the fire went forth lightning. I mean, they're in a different realm than we can even imagine. And the living creatures ran and returned as the appearance of a flash of lightning. That's how fast they move. You can't even snap your fingers fast enough. And they've already gone. Fast as lightning in a very instant of time. Another thing about the angels, they don't take naps. In Revelation chapter 4, they don't sleep. Look what it says in Revelation 4:8. The four beasts had each of them six wings about them. They're the angels. They're full of eyes within, and they rest not day and night. They don't rest, saying, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, which was and which is and is to come." We need rest because of our physical bodies in this earth, because of all the effects of what's gone on. But the angels, they're in a different realm. They don't need any rest whatsoever. They just carry on. And we know the demons also are the same thing. They don't rest either, that means. So that's why you got to bind the demons and stop their works even when you're resting. What you can do is you learn how to pray and put the power of God in operation. In Psalms 95, verse 1, it's talking about how the enemy will come against you. And it says, "They shall not be afraid for the terror by night." The devil brings terror at night. "The arrow that flies by day," that's his attacks during the day. "The pestilence that walks in darkness, nor the destruction that wastes at noonday." That's around the clock. They're working. Angels do not sleep. They are continually working at all times. Now, there's different classifications of them. There are the seraphim, there's the cherubim, and there is all of the cherubs, and there's also the angels, just what general ones that carry out the work of the Lord. And they are messenger angels, whereas warrior angels that do different things, and worshiping angels. We see in Genesis chapter 3, verse 24, where it talks about the cherubim. It says in 24, "He drove out the man, and he placed at the east of the Garden of Eden cherubims and a flaming sword which turned every way to keep the way of the tree of life, to guard it." So angels will be there to guard things. We also see that angels were in the Old Testament era, they were in where the presence of God was. We see in Exodus chapter 25, verse 18, "They were to make two cherubims of gold, of beaten work, thou shalt make them." This is where they're going to put over the mercy seat, in the two ends of the mercy seat. "One cherub on the one end, the other cherub on the other end, even the mercy seat shall you make the cherubims, the two ends themselves. And the cherubims stretch forth their wings on high, covering the mercy seat with their wings, and their faces shall look one toward another. Toward the mercy seat shall the faces of the cherubims be." One's looking one way, one's the other way, over the very throne of God, where the presence of God would manifest in the Old Testament. You put the mercy seat above upon the ark, and the ark where you put the testimony that I shall give thee. And that's where he would meet with thee, God said, "And I'll commune with thee from above the mercy seat, from between the two cherubims, that is, which are upon the ark of the testimony of all things which I will give thee in commandment unto the children of Israel." So where these ones are at the very presence of God, where the presence of God would manifest. There also were what they call the seraphim. And we see these ones in Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1, "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Above it stood the seraphims." These were different ones. They're up in heaven. "Each one had six wings. With twain he covered his face, with twain he covered his feet, and with twain he did fly." These angels had wings, and they were before the presence of God. They cried unto him and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." And the posts of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke, which is the glory of God, the very presence of God, as they would continually worship him. There's also types of angels by their service of what they do. We see over in Daniel chapter 8, verse 16, "And there are places where angels came, and when that God had certain angels name themselves." These are true angels. Daniel 8, verse 16, "I heard a man's voice between the banks of Eli, which called and said, Gabriel, make this man to understand the vision." That was the name of the leader of the messenger angels, Gabriel. We see over in chapter 9 in Daniel, in verse 21, "Yea, while I was speaking in prayer, even the man Gabriel," he appeared like a man, "whom I'd seen in the vision at the beginning, being caused to fly swiftly, touched me about the time of the evening oblation. And he informed me and talked with me." Here's the angel came to communicate with him and bring the message from God. He said, "O Daniel, I am now come forth to give thee skill and understanding." He came to bring revelation to him. We also see in the time of Luke chapter 1, talking about the birth when Jesus was going to come forth, with dealing with Mary here. And here's dealing with Zacharias here. First of all, the angel said, I am Gabriel, revealing his name, that shall stand in the presence of God, and sent to speak unto thee and to show thee these glad tidings, how he's going to have a child, which is going to be John the Baptist. And we see over in verse 26, in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel, this is when he came to appear to Mary, was sent from God into a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. So here, Gabriel, what's Gabriel doing? Gabriel is bringing forth messages from God. Gabriel is the leader of the messenger angels that delivers things. There's also the warrior angels. Warrior angels fight. They fight against the enemies. And the leader of that is Michael. In Daniel chapter 12, verse 1, it says, at that time shall Michael stand up, that great prince will stand for the children of thy people. He's the leader of the warrior angels. We see how he needed to come on the scene when an angel was coming to bring information to Daniel when he was seeking for revelation. In Daniel 10, verse 10, a hand touched me and set me upon my knees, upon the palm of my hands. And he said unto me, O Daniel, a man greatly beloved, understand the words that I speak unto you. Stand upright, for unto thee am I now sent. And when he had spoken this word unto me, I stood trembling. And he said unto me, Fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that thou didst set thine heart to understand and to chasten thyself before thy God, thy words were heard, and I am come for thy words. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 120 days. Who's that? Remember? Who are we fighting against? The principalities, the powers, or the authorities, the rulers of the darkness of this world, the spiritual wickedness in the heavenly places. This is Satan, who is highly organized in his evil spirits that are operating over places, over cities, over states, over territories, nations. And this is the one called the one who was over the kingdom of Persia. And he withstood this angel from bringing this message to Daniel for 21 days. That also tells you something. Angels have power. Not only do God's angels have power, but the enemy's angels have power. Even though they're in chains of darkness, they haven't lost power in a sense that they're weak nothings, though they have power. And God's power, of course, is greater. And so Michael, one of the chief princes, he was the leader of the warrior angels, came to help me, and I remained there with the kings of Persia. So he came and fought against this one so he could get through. But there was a 21-day battle. Because remember, he said that from the first day back here, he said that in verse 12, from the first day that you did set your heart to understand, when he began to pray, he said, I'm come. But it took him 21 days to get through. This is why you have to understand, when you pray, there is warfare going on in the realm of the spirit between the angels of God and the angels of the devil, who are trying to stop things from happening. This is why you and I have to pray without ceasing continually, as Daniel did, until we see the breakthrough come forth. This is important to understand. This is true in the area of intercession. This is true in the area for deliverance. This is true in the area of seeing changes come, moving mountains and so forth, when you put the power of God in operation. The evil spirits will fight against them. We see down in verse 18. Then there came again and touched me one like the appearance of a man, and he strengthened me, also showing you that angels will strengthen. Angels brought strength after Jesus had been tempted for the 40 days. The angel came and strengthened him as well. He came and strengthened me. Oh man. He said, O man, greatly beloved, fear not, peace be unto thee. Be strong, yea, be strong. When he'd spoken unto me, I was strengthened. He spoke God's word and produced strength. And said, Let my Lord speak, for thou hast strengthened me. Then he said, Knowest thou wherefore I come unto thee? And now will I return to fight with the prince of Persia. And when I'm gone forth, lo, the prince of Grecia shall come. That was the next kingdom that was going to come, that the devil had those principalities ruling, the Grecian kingdom that was ruling the earth through Alexander as it began. So these are shows you what's really going on in the realm of the spirit. There is warfare. We see over in Revelation chapter 12. This is what's going to happen at the end of the 6,000 year period of the lease that man has had for dominion in the earth. At the end of that time, God is going to begin his rule, and he's going to deal with these guys. Satan has had authority because it was transferred into his hands because of man's sin, but that time is fast coming to an end. And look what's going to happen in Revelation 12:7. There was war in heaven, and Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels and prevailed not. Neither was their place any more in heaven. They're going to be cast out, and they're going to be eliminated. And they'll be cast down to the earth. And of course, that's why it says Satan has great wrath, knowing he has a short time. He knows it's only 1260 days before you're going to be wiped out and you're going to be cast into the lake of fire. And there's going to be great havoc during that particular time. But so we see also that they fight. They war. Michael, of course, the leader of God's warrior angels, fight against the dragon, who is Satan, and conquer him. Now, one thing, they only do things that what God directs them to do. And it's interesting, in Jude verse 9, it says, Michael, the archangel, head of the warrior angels, when contending with the devil, he disputed about the body of Moses, durst not bring against him a railing accusation, but said, the Lord rebuke thee. Apparently, there was a battle over his body. But notice, it said here that he didn't say, as far as in his own authority, about rebuking him. He said, the Lord rebuke thee. Because remember, he's an angel and the devil's an angel. They're on the same par. But the Lord, of course, he's the one who is stronger than him. And he said, the Lord rebuke thee. So this also shows you the fact that angels on their own cannot just go and conquer other angels, as far as having authority or dominion over them. It has to have someone who has dominion authority over them. And who has dominion authority over all the evil angels today? You and I do. We have authority over all the power of the enemy, and we can command them. And what happens then? The angels that hearken to the voice of the word go forth and do the battle, not on their own, but because you and I have commanded them, because we are the ones who speak his word. Remember, they perform the word of God, and they're going to carry out the destructive work against the enemy. So Satan was the leader of the praise and worship angels in heaven, kicked out all these evil spirits now and under chains of darkness. And you must understand, though, because of the fall of man, these angels are operating. They're operating. Satan is highly organized in what he does. In fact, when it speaks here about how Jesus was set at how we've been raised him from the dead and set him his own right hand in the heavenly places. It says where? Far above all principality and power, which means exousia, means authority, and might and dominion. These are evil spirits operating in what they're carrying out in the heavenlies. And every name this name, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. Showing the fact that there's quite a battle that goes on in the heavenlies against all these ones, and they're highly organized. We see in Ephesians 6:12 clearly, we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Our battle's not against physical people. They're just used by the enemy. The enemy's working through them. But where's our battle against? Principalities, powers or authorities, the rulers of the darkness of this age. The word means age, aeon. And against spiritual wickedness in the high places or in the heavens. Satan is highly organized, and he is working in all these areas. God's angels, of course, are highly organized, and they are working, of course, to carry out the things that God wants to bring forth, which is destruction of the enemies. Another thing you have to know is the angels have great knowledge in the earth. 2 Samuel chapter 14, verse 20. He speaks here about, in the midst of this, about the wisdom of an angel. He says, to fetch about this form of speech, hath the servant Joab done this thing? My Lord is wise. According to the wisdom of an angel of God to know all things that are in the earth. They know everything that's in the earth. So they already are aware of everything that's going on. They know it all. They just need to be put in operation to conquer the enemies. And they're going to be done by us as you and I operate in authority to release the power of God. Now, even though they know all these things in the earth, they do not know the things of the gospel. They simply follow what they're told. It's withheld from them as far as them having this. We see this in 1 Peter 1, verse 12. Unto whom it was revealed that not unto themselves, but unto us they did minister the things which are now reported unto you by them that have preached the gospel unto you with the Holy Ghost sent down from heaven, which things the angels desire to look into. They don't know the gospel. The gospel is revealed, remember, by the Holy Spirit to those in covenant relationship with God, and it's revealed unto us. So it's not revealed unto them. They just simply carry it out. So they desire to look into it. They do not know these things. It's not given them to know. Now, one other scripture we ought to look at for a moment to understand what's being said. In Psalms 8, we see quite a mistake in the King James Version. We pick up here in Psalms 8, verse 4. What is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou visitest him? For thou hast made him a little lower than the angels, and hast crowned him with glory and honor. Did God make man lower than the angels? No, he did not. He were made in the very image of God, in the same level that he, as far as, but under God, of course, but in the same image of God, not after the angels. Well, why did they translate this way? I don't know. All I can tell you is this is the word angels. I put the cursor over it. I want you to notice in the lower window, number 430, it's the word Elohim. Elohim is the word for God. It is plural. And to show you the usage of it to prove this, look at this. Here is the usage down here. 2,606 times this word Elohim is used in the Old Testament. 2,346 times is translated God. 244, little god, referring to false gods. Judge, God, God is great, mighty, exceeding Godward. One time is translated angels, and this is where it is. Erroneously. The word for angel is the word malach. It is not the word Elohim. It is a mistake in the translation. It is talking about the Godhead because it's talking about Elohim, plural, the Godhead. He's made him made man a little lower than God or the Godhead and has crowned him with glory and honor. Now, over in Hebrews, it says something a little bit different. Some people haven't understood this. I just want to share this with you to help you to understand this. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 5, whereunto the angels hath he put, not put in subjection the world to come wherever we speak. One in a certain place testified, saying, what is man that thou art mindful of him, or the son of man that thou visited him? Thou hast made him a little lower than the angels, and here it just made a change. This is why I think they translate it that way, because this is made a change from what was said in the Old Testament, because it is the word angelos. Thou crownest him with glory and honor, and didst set him over the work of thy hands. Thou hast put all things in subjection under his feet. For the end that he put all in subjection under him, he left nothing that is put not put under him. But now we see not yet all things put under him. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death. In other words, how did that happen? Because Jesus was made sin in order to be able to submit himself to them, so that then, what was the purpose? Remember what it says in, he was to taste death for every man, as it says, but we see that verse 14 says, like much as the children were partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil. Otherwise, Jesus had to go through the avenue of death to destroy Satan. He had to go down there. He paid the price in hell for 3 days and three nights, accomplishing redemption. He also took back the keys of hell and death from the devil. So he went and destroyed him who had the power of death, took it back away from him, and he accomplished all this. But he had to be able to go down there, so he had to be submissive to him in the sense that's what happened when he was made sin. So that's what it's talking back here. when it talks about in verse 9, so you understand what it's saying. He was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death. This is for a short time, a little lower for the suffering of death. That was the purpose. That's all. Crowned with honor and glory, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man so he could accomplish this redemptive work. So you understand, it was not talking about man, though, being made lower than the angels. We are made in the very image of God. And of course, because of sin, that's what caused man to be under Satan's dominion. And so everybody who's not born again is still under Satan's dominion. But once you get born again, you come back into relationship with God. Now you are in authority over Satan. Now you can conquer him and all the evil spirits in your life. And that's what's, of course, important. Now, talking about these spirits, as we already saw, that they are ministering spirits sent forth to minister for us the heirs of salvation. So what should we do? In chapter 2, verse 1, it says, therefore, because, tying together what was just said, that they are ministering for us the heirs of salvation, therefore we ought, or we must, this means necessary as binding, it's the word die, translated must the majority of times, we must give the more earnest heed to the things which we've heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. You see, the angels are ministering for us, and we've got to be ready to do what God says. We've got to give them more earnest heed to these things. We can't let them slip. Because what happens? When you obey, you're going to be blessed. But also, he goes on and says, if the word spoken by angels was steadfast, that's right, to bring blessings. But what else also? Remember, God's word also tells you if you don't obey, you're going to have curses coming upon you. And every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of reward. That meant they saw judgments come. God is a just God. He's a fair God. He is right. But he has a standard of righteousness. He made things the way things are is according to righteousness. Therefore, you walk in righteousness, you're right with him, you will be blessed. God will do everything in his word to perform it for you. You walk contrary to it. You transgress, you're disobedient, you're going to see curses come upon you because that is the penalty or the result, the reward, essentially, for those who walk contrary to his ways. This is why we've got to be obedient. He goes in verse 3, says, how shall we escape? We won't. If we neglect so great salvation, we must possess that salvation. We are to work out our own salvation, walking in line with the word and possessing everything that God has told us to possess. And we can, through, of course, Jesus Christ has given us authority. We can conquer every enemy. Which of the first began to be spoken by the Lord was confirmed unto us by them that heard him. Therefore, what this is saying is, these angels are ministering for us the heir of salvation. We've got to be sure that we're giving earnest heed to the things that are spoken. You can't be letting them slip. Because what's been said is going to happen, including if you're disobedient, then you're going to see the result of that with the curses that'll come. And if we neglect the great salvation, then we're going to miss out on what God has, and we're going to see the penalty for the rejecting of the Word of God. Now, another thing about angels. Angels, where do they go from? They go back and forth from heaven to earth in a flash. Remember, like the flash of lightning. We see in Genesis chapter 28, verse 12. Here's where Jacob dreamed. Remember, and behold, a ladder was set up on earth, and the top of it reached to heaven. And behold, the angels of God ascending and descending on it, going up and back. That's what the angels do. So this angel, the angels are ascending and descending, going up and back, just in a flash, and flash. They can be up in heaven 1 second, down in the next flash, carrying out the things of God. And so they are moving all over the place to accomplish what God wants. The other thing is, angels you do not worship. Remember that angels are made in the image below us. We are made in the image of God. Here is a case where in Revelation 22, when John was getting the revelation of all the things that were going to happen and the judgments to come, verse 22, chapter 22, verse 8, I, John, saw these things and heard them. When I'd heard and seen, I fell down to worship before the feet of the angel. He was going to worship the angel, which showed me these things. What did the angel say? Thus say he unto me, saith he unto me, see thou do it not. For I am thy fellow servant, and the brethren of the prophets, and of them which keep the sayings of this book, worship God. Otherwise, you do not worship angels. Worship of angels is wrong. It is sin, and you do something you do not do. Now, in seeing these angels be put into operation, God wants us to put the angels into operation. First of all, what are they? They're performers of the word, as we saw. And we see in Isaiah chapter 55, verse 10, as the rain cometh down, the snow from heaven, and returneth not thither, but watereth the earth, and maketh it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please and prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. Who is the one who performs this? It is the angels of God that carry this out. Again, going back to Psalms 103 for a moment. When the word is been spoken, the angels of God go forth to carry this out. Psalms 103, verse 20. Bless the Lord, ye his angels that excel in strength, remember, that are mighty in manifested power, that do his commandments. They will not do what you say unless it's in line with the word. You can't tell angels to do something that's contrary to the word. They only do the commandments. And they hearken to the voice of the word that they hear. Well, how does this work? When you and I pray, we've talked about this, we pray to the Father in the name of Jesus. And when we pray in the New Testament, we pray the scripture promise, making a spiritual demand of what's due us, which is what the word ask means in the Greek. And what happens when we're praying? Jesus is at the right hand of the Father, and he is in a present ministry as the high priest of the covenant. In Hebrews 4:14, it says, seeing then we have a great high priest that's passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. He is at the right hand of the Father, and he takes that which we speak and does something with it, which you'll see in a moment. But because we have this great high priest, see, Jesus isn't sitting up there doing nothing. He's carrying out a ministry. Let us hold fast our profession. Profession is the same word translated confession in places. It's homologia, which means to say the same thing. You're speaking things with your mouth, speaking the word of God, and you're to hold fast speaking the word, confessing the word, because Jesus is going to do something with it. In Luke chapter 12, verse 8, it says, also I say unto whosoever shall confess me before men. Who is that? Me is Jesus. Well, who else is Jesus? He's the word. When you speak the word of God, what's going to happen? Him shall the Son of Man also confess before the angels of God. Therefore, when you confess the word, Jesus takes that and confesses it before the angels, who are going to hearken to the voice of the word to go forth and to perform it. But also, you got to know this. He that denieth me before men shall be denied before the angels of God. What does that tell you? Angels are not automatically operating. If you speak wrong words, things contrary to the word of God, are the angels going to go into operation to protect you or accomplish things or perform the promises and bring things to pass? No. You've got to be sure that you're not denying him. And how would I deny him? By speaking contrary to the word. We don't want to speak contrary to the word. We want to speak the right things. Now, how do we put these angels to work? We're going to be speaking. Now, can you just tell the angels directly something to do? No, we already saw. It's Jesus who tells them something to do. We also see that you can put them in operation by prayer to the Father. We see this in Matthew 26, verse 53. This is Jesus speaking in the garden. Remember when they came and they were coming to take Jesus, and the one disciple took the sword, cut off his ear, and of course Jesus then, in another part of the Gospels, healed his ear, was put back on, and then we come down to verse 53, and he makes a statement. He says, Because in verse 2 he said, put away your sword, or you're going to perish. He said, thinkest thou that I cannot now pray to my Father, and he, talking about the Father, shall presently give me more than 12 legions of angels? In other words, how was Jesus going to put the angels in operation? He would pray to the Father, and the Father would send the angels forth. So what are you and I going to do? We're going to pray to the Father in the name of Jesus, speak the scripture promise, and then the Father is going to send those angels through. Jesus is going to be confessing it before the angels. They're going to be all involved in seeing these angels come forth. So otherwise, you don't direct the angels. You pray so that God sends the angels. And notice it said more than 12 legions. A legion was like 6,826 men at the time of Augustus, with all the other foot soldiers and horsemen. So we're talking about a tremendous amount, 12 legions. I mean, that's about 80,000 angels or so that would be put into operation. Otherwise, Jesus obviously must have known what all was going on with all the demons that were arrayed against him. And he said, hey, I could pray and God had brought these 80,000 angels on the scene and they'd have taken care of this whole bunch. Because that's how he operated everything in the realm of the spirit. You and I can put the angels in operation that will conquer all of these enemies in our life. Angels will do great and mighty things. Now, for angels to operate, we already saw that we're going to have to pray, we're going to have to speak the word, and see them be put in operation. There are other conditions. Psalms 34, verse 7 tells you something. The angel of the Lord encamps round about them that fear him and delivers them. This means they'll protect you. If they encamp around you, they're protecting you. Do angels automatically protect you just because you're born again? No. A lot of people think that. Well, if that was the case, why would I have all these problems? Well, because they must not have met the conditions in some way. Notice the condition, them that fear him. The fear of the Lord has to be before us. Remember what the fear of the Lord is. You fear God and keep his commandments. If you have fear of God, you'll depart from iniquity. If you have the fear of God, you'll hate evil. If you have the fear of God, you delight greatly in his commandments. We did a teaching on that not too long ago. You look up all the stuff, you go through those teachings, you'll see all the conditions for having the fear of God. Otherwise, we got to be doing what the word says and walking in line with his ways. When you meet the conditions, then the angels of God, and notice, they will protect you. That's part of their ministry. And they will also deliver you. That means they will fight for you. They will bring forth a deliverance from enemies that have come against you. They'll deliver you out of the hands of the enemies and their attacks. Also, we see over in Psalms 91, seeing what angels will do. And again, we have to meet the conditions. Verse 1 says, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide in the shadow of the Almighty. You got to be abiding in him and dwelling in his word. I will say of the Lord, he's my refuge, my fortress, my God, in him will I trust. You're going to be speaking words, because remember, how do the angels get put in operation? Through words. You're speaking the words, and now also you're going to be in faith because you're trusting in God to perform his word. Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler, from the noisome pestilence. I mean, you got to have confidence in God delivering you. You know, you got to be in faith to see God perform anything, including the angels work on your behalf. Trusting and knowing, surely he will deliver you. He covers thee with feathers, or his wondrous wings, I trust. His truth will be thy shield and buckler. He will protect you. But again, how's this all involved? It's involved with the word, because the truth has to be put forth. You're going to speak forth the word, because that's what God performs. He performs the word. This is why you pray the scripture promises or speak the word of God. That's when they'll go into operation. Thou shalt not be afraid. You can't have fear. If you have fear, you're an open door for the devil, and the angels won't work on your behalf. You cannot be afraid for the terror by night, nor the arrow that flies by day, the pestilence that walks in darkness, the destruction that wastes at noonday. So conquering fear is essential in your life. Fear not. Have no fear. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand. It shall not come nigh thee. What does this talk about? Why are they falling at your side? Why are 10,000 at your right hand? Because you're using your right hand, which is what? About authority and power. And what do? With your right hand? You smite enemies. Your sword, you use that sword, and you smite those enemies with power and authority to conquer them. This means you're obviously taking dominion over the enemies, and they're just getting wiped out left and right, wherever you go. It shall not come nigh you, because you're engaging in warfare. If you don't engage in warfare, the demons will get to you. Many people think, well, I wonder why the devil's attacking me. And a lot of people have tried to say, oh, it's because you're in sin. Well, not necessarily. Because you have problems or things coming against you doesn't mean you're necessarily in sin opening the door. What happened with Paul in the book of Acts? He got attacked everywhere which way he went. He wasn't sinning. He's out there preaching the gospel. He just didn't understand how to deal with the enemy yet until he finally learned his authority and started using that and started conquering all the enemies. And then he started overcoming them every place he was going. See? But he wasn't sinning open the door, so don't think that. We have to use our authority against the enemy. Only with thine eyes will you behold and see the reward of the wicked, which is their destruction. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, because you said he's my refuge, my fortress, in whom I'm trusting, even the Most High, thy habitation, my dwelling place. Remember, that was the first verse, that you are to dwell in the secret place of the Most High and abide in the shadow of the Almighty. And how do you do that? Through the Word. You're walking in the Word, you're dwelling in Him, you're doing everything that He tells you to do. So you made Him your habitation. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. Tremendous promises if we meet the conditions. For He shall give His angels charge over thee to keep thee, to guard thee in all thy ways. So the angels are going to guard you from what? From evil befalling you. And they'll guard you from plagues coming to you. That means this is how the angels are going to be operation for you to live in divine health and also to have no evil befalling you. We can live through this life if we conquer all sin, which we can, and we also have to do spiritual warfare to conquer the enemies and also speak the word to put the angels in operation. The angels will, when they go in operation, because we met the conditions, no evil will befall us, and no plague will come nigh our dwelling. That is spiritual reality that will happen if we meet the conditions. He give His angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways, and they will absolutely accomplish these things. They'll bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon, thou shalt trample underfoot. Notice this is talking about you and me. You do have to operate in authority. If you don't learn to operate in authority over the enemies are going to get to you. And they can beat you up left and right and cause you all kinds of problems with sickness, disease, bondages, all kinds of things coming at you. We have to conquer them in our life if we're going to see victory. Just because you're walking in line with the Word and the angels are going to protect you, that doesn't mean that everything is gone from you if you haven't cast it all out and conquered the enemies in your life. This is why deliverance is absolutely mandatory for all of us. Because He has set His love upon me, therefore I'll deliver Him. Otherwise, another condition. If you're not loving the Lord, you think the angels are going to work? Well, I spoke the word, but I'm over here in unforgiveness, resentment, or attitudes, or getting in fear, or getting in doubt, or what are these things? It's not going to happen. I will set him on high because he's known my name. You do have to know the name. With the name of Jesus, the name through faith in the name releases the power and the authority and brings forth the victory. You got to have confidence in the name. Verse 15, he'll call upon me and I'll answer him. I'll be with him in trouble. I'll deliver him and honor him. These are the great promises that he will bring to pass in our life. And with long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. That's because we meet the conditions. And we're going to see the angels accomplish these great things in our life. A couple more scriptures before we stop. Angels will go before you and they will do a work to bring you to what God has for you. Exodus 23:20. Behold, I send an angel before thee to keep thee, that means to guard you in the way, not only to protect you, we saw they'll protect you, but also to bring you to the place that I prepared. They'll be involved in working, opening up doors and working on directing things, and things just seem to fall in place and to bring you to the place that you prepared. They'll do these kind of things. And the Holy Spirit, of course, in the New Testament dwelling in us, will lead us and guide us in these things. Beware of him and obey his voice. Provoke him not. What's he speak? He speaks the words. We've got to obey the word. He'll not pardon your transgressions. Otherwise, if you're walking in sin, he's not going to just, well, that doesn't make any difference. No, that's going to stop him from working. For my name is in him. if thou shalt indeed obey his voice, which would be the word of God, because that's all they speak, and do all that I speak, then I'll be an enemy to thy enemies and an adversary to thy adversaries. The angels will be warriors and fighters and enemies against the devils and adversaries against them. For my angels shall go before thee. They will. But what are they going to do? Fight all the enemies without you doing something? No. They're going to bring you in unto all the Amorites, Hittites, Perizzites, Canaanites, Hivites, Jebusites, and I'll cut them off. Bring you in unto them. They're not going to lead you away from them. They're going to lead you unto them. Wait a minute. I thought they were protecting me. Why are they bringing me up against the enemies? Because you have to confront them and cast them out. And you have to destroy their works. And God will cut them off and eliminate them. Otherwise, it's not run away from your enemies. It's confront your enemies and kick them out. God has given you authority. You can cast out everything. You can destroy everything. You can move every mountain. You have total dominion authority. You can stop every work of the enemy. You've got to get confidence in that. You cannot have fear, and you've got to engage in the spiritual warfare and use your weapons to overcome all the enemies. The angels will go forth and bring you to the place that he has for you. Without engaging in spiritual warfare, you're not going to get very far, and you're not going to see things happen. But if the angels are in operation, they will have charge over you in all your ways. No more evil, no more sickness, disease. Every enemy gets cut off. You go in and possess all the promises in your life. That is spiritual reality in the New Testament. Angels, we've got to put them in operation. We've got to make sure we meet the conditions and do what it says and know what's happening. Know that these angels are going into operation for us. Well, we've begun talking about this morning. Tonight, we've got a lot more to talk about. We're going to talk more about angels. We'll be talking about the messenger angels and how they work. We'll be talking about the warring angels as we go through this. It's very important for us to understand the activity of angels, how to put them in operation, what they will do, and make sure you meet all the conditions to see them perform their great work. Remember, they're ministers for you and me, the heirs of salvation. Say this with me. Heavenly Father, I thank you and praise you for the word of God that brings revelation about angels. Thank you for revealing to me about what angels are and how to put them in operation, and that there are conditions that must be met. I will meet the conditions. I will do what the word says. I will pray the word, confess the word. I will know, because I have faith and I trust in the word, that the angels will go forth and minister for me, the heir of salvation. They will have charge over me to keep me in all my ways, to deliver me from all evil. No plague comes nigh my dwelling, because I've met the conditions and I have cast out all the demons and I have engaged in spiritual warfare to destroy every work of the enemy. As I am a doer of the word, the angels will work to destroy my enemies, and they will work to bring me to the place that God's prepared for me. I thank you, Lord, for the angels that will work in the performance of the word to accomplish everything that you have said in your word. Thank you. I'll make sure I put them in operation. In Jesus' name, amen. That's what Jesus did. That's what you and I do. Praise God. Father, we thank you for all you brought forth. We will be hearers and doers of this word. We will see the angels go forth and accomplish everything, because we'll be doers of the word. We praise you for all that your word declares and what we know you will accomplish. And we give you glory and honor for them, and messenger angels ministering to us as we meet your conditions. We give you glory for this, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.